Scoff and Quaff Show with Jules Serkin on Channel Radio.
Hello and a warm welcome to St. Patrick's Day. I'm trying not to say any times, you see, because we're syndicated, Chris.
It's a lovely feeling being syndicated, isn't it? Hello, Jules.
A warm something.
Can't say warm something.
Can't say morning, can't say afternoon.
Nope.
It's a beautiful day in Kent. We were not saying what time of day, but it is beautiful. Show 83. It's St. Patrick's Day. We're having a little jig today. And abundance of food in the studio because we have Diane Perry from the Cookery Studio. And she's brought in to come in bearing lovely gifts. Good morning, Diane.
Good morning, Jules.
Good morning, Diane.
You've come from Baddlesmere, Faversham.
Yeah.
What have you brought in?
Well, I've got a little selection of sweet things because I know that we're going to be looking at sherry, and I was hoping it was going to be sweet sherry because it's all macaroons, not macaron. Mm. So the English macaroons, which go very well with Spanish sherry.
Lovely.
A bit of Italian, so I've got biscotti.
Oh.
The macaroons are great for you because they're gluten-free.
Fabulous. And I shall be eating those.
Yeah. And I have another sort of oat selection with lots of chocolate and peanut butter again for you because I know your gluten-free tendencies.
Lovely. Well, thank you, Diane, and a big hello to Robbie who will be listening. And then my co-presenter today is the lovely and very debonair Chris Pollard. Chris Connect It on the Twitter. Good morning. Good day.
Good day to you, Jules, again.
Good something. Good morrow.
Well, good morrow.
Yes. And what are we tasting today?
Well, we're going to be tasting a few things. I understand we've got a gentleman on the telephone from Spain.
It's
a place called Moreira. Mm. And we're going to include on that, we're going to discuss the Triana Sherry, which is from a bodega Hidalgo, which I know Colin knows very well. And that's going to go beautifully with some of the food that Diane has very kindly put in. I mean, I'm looking across here and it's just food. It's wonderful.
I know, it's my ideal show. And of course, I'm sure Colin Harkness, if you're following him on Twitter, it's at Colin on Wine. He's probably slumped right now in a bodega, isn't he?
I wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah. So he'll be calling in, or we'll be calling him about 10 past 11. He is our resident Spanish wine expert, and he wouldn't be drawn into St. Patrick's Day.
I wouldn't have thought so.
No.
I wouldn't, unless, well, there's going to be Irish people out there celebrating.
A lot, yeah. A lot of Irish restaurants and pubs and bars out there in the Alicante-Valencia region. We'll also be playing out, of course, last Thursday I was frolicking at the Taste of Kent Awards. Fabulous evening. The catering was done by Mama Feel Goods, Maddie, and well done to all of you. Great service there. I was on the naughty table with Kent Farmers Market.
But I understand you were frolicking on someone's knee.
Well, there is a story to that. I was interviewing, you see, and you know, by a couple of hours into the evening, one got tired.
A certain Matthew Kiersey Lawson's knee from Kent Fine Foods, who said his... Well, I saw him limping, you see, because I was at Aylesford Farmers Market on Sunday, and I saw him in his new corporate colours. Corporate colours, they've got these lovely puffer jackets, which are kind of... actually, not far of a short of a, of an Irish green.
Right.
And then they've got Kent-made Kent Fine Foods in yellow across the left pocket. Well, I saw him limping along to the stage, and I shouted to him, what's the problem? He said, well, it's that Jules Serkin. He said, she was sitting on my knee for 20 minutes at the awards on Thursday, and he said, it's still numb.
Well, I was interviewing the Milk House, lovely chef from the Milk House, and they were nominees, and great chef there, a little Kiwi man, as I remember. And I just found that his knee, Matthew Kiersey Lawson's knee, was, you know, in the area. So I perched.
Well, I don't blame you.
Made his day, frankly.
Well, he did say that.
He said something much ruder to me. I cannot mention it on air. We will be... So possibly you'll be one of the interviews that we're playing out today. If we don't fit them all in today, we will try and play some next week as well, because they're all important. And of course, Aylesford Farmers Market won.
Yes, they did. And as I told you, I was down there on Sunday and I had a chat with Steve Woods. And I think all power to them. I mean, he's done superb work. And on, as I say, I had a chat with Steve. I went along to the proper tea company, young Peter, who was here last week as a guest.
Proper tea. Sorry, I thought you said property. I thought you were going into the estate agents.
Proper tea company.
Yes.
And I bought
proper diction, please.
Sorry. And I bought the Golden Monkey.
Oh, did
which
you?
Which we tasted yeah. last week. And I also bought some of the coconut tea.
I loved that.
Wasn't it gorgeous? Mm. And I've also bought a tea from called Pushong, and that's a green tea.
Well, that does sound lovely. I did notice that I felt very perky the next day, and I think it was down to his teas.
Undoubtedly.
Peter Wiggins, he's a great, great expert, isn't he?
Yes, he was. I loved his passion.
Yes.
He spoke about tea like wine experts do, and it was wonderful to hear his passion, really was.
Yeah.
And also something else I did, because you were talking about the carrot and garlic chutney from Katie's Great Preservations, I bought a jar.
And have you tried any yet?
I have tried some. And it's absolutely, it's beautiful.
You agree with me?
Oh, I do. But it's didn't eat the whole jar in one evening.
I'm afraid my husband and I did.
So I heard.
Well, I ate actually the whole jar. I left him sort of dregs at the bottom. And I said, you've got to have that. And it was, I couldn't stop eating it. It's the combination of the chilli and the sort of curried spicy flavour. And I think probably the sugar as well was a little bit of sugar.
So I agree with you. I mean, it was very Moorish.
It was.
And also, just to finalise what I did down there as well, I've been going to the, they're called the Dudders Cider Makers.
Let's have a jig, darling, while you tell us.
Oh, well, I can't dance.
Well, you tell us what
all right.
happened.
Well, I went to the Dudders Cider Makers, and they make cider, funnily enough. It's all in the name, that's the clue. But we buy our apples and pears from there.
Do you?
Yes, they do these wonderful...
They're squeezed.
Before they're squeezed, that's right. And we're eating Reuben's apples at the moment, and they're conference pears. And I mean, for £2 a bag, they're really good value. But the Reuben's apples, I'd highly recommend. They're superb.
Are they sort of a rosy apple?
Funnily enough, yes, they're kind of rosy yellowish. I meant to bring one with me. Actually, Miriam's got one in the green room, but she's kept it.
I'm not sure we've got any room to eat anything with all this we've got.
I wouldn't have thought so.
What events have you got on for St. Patrick's Day?
What events have I got, says he, looking around for his event sheet. Well, I know I've got some events on, because I was looking at them just now.
Is it in your cuff?
No. Yes. Here we are. I found it, says he, Mr. Organised. Right. Events that we have on this week. Number one, we have the Checkers Kitchen Mardi Gras Supper with the guest chef, Ralph Cade. And that's on Saturday the 21st of March at 7:30 p.m. and that's £25 per head. And the inspiration comes from New Orleans and San Francisco. And here's an example of what you may be able to eat that evening. Sweet corn fritters, crab and clam chowder. Oh, that sounds nice.
Mm.
Jambalaya. A vegetable jambalaya is also available. And lime and toasted coconut cream pie.
Oh,
I think we should go
that's my
that.
One weakness.
Mm. Oh, that's a surprise.
Yes.
Their website is 3wscheckersrestaurant.com. And to book, you can either email info@checkers.kitchen or you can telephone them on 01304 362 288. Now, following up on that, we have Dev's Menu Trials at the Ambrette in Margate, Rye and Canterbury, and that's on Sunday the 22nd of March.
So this is Dev Biswal.
Yes.
Lovely man.
I've never met him.
I have frolicked with him as well.
Have you? Yeah. There's a surprise.
Yes.
And it says here, an exciting opportunity to try Dev's brand new dishes that could be added to the new menus at the Ambrette. They will take you through a sampler menu and will then take comments and feedback. They use seasonal local ingredients with regional Indian cooking. And their aim is to promote this new and energetic concept of Kentish dining to other towns and cities in the United Kingdom and beyond. Excellent. 10-course tasting menu for £29.99. You can book online at www.theambrette.co.uk.
That sounds delicious. Will you save the rest for later?
I will do, of course.
Is there anything happening on the Twitter, though?
Well, there is.
There must be.
As always.
Yes.
We have two new listeners, one called Ambrette Restaurant and Black Circle Coffee.
Funnily, we mentioned the Ambrette, and there they are.
And there they are, exactly, immediately.
It just shows that the tweets work.
Exactly. Well, yes, they do. We've had various retweets as well from Ken Heron. from Caroline and Liz, who are the sisters from Riverford Organics. We've had gluten-free baking have been retweeting. VJ Game, thank you. They're listening in as well. Hugo Bernardo, favorited.
Hugo Banana?
Hugo Bernardo.
Sorry.
Andrew from at Muschop.
Muschop.
That was that was earlier this morning, and that's all at the moment.
That sounds fabulous. And right, so I think Chris, we'll have a little bit of as it's St. Patrick's Day, a little bit of Thin Lizzy, and the boys are back in town. This is going to be loud.
But man, I still think them cats are great. They were asking if you were around, how you was, where you could be found. Told them you were living downtown, driving all the old men crazy. The boys are back in town, the boys are back in town. I said, the boys are back in town, the boys are back in town. The boys are back in town. Chick that used to dance a lot. Every night she'd be on the floor shaking what she'd got. Man, when I tell you she was cool, she was red hot. I mean she was steaming. And that time over at Johnny's place, well, this chick got up and she slapped Johnny's face. Man, we just fell about the place. If that chick don't wanna know, forget her. The boys are back in town, the boys are back in town. I said,
Oh, that was lovely, Thin Lizzy. I rather used to have a crush on Phil Lynott in his little tight leather pants. I don't know if Nurse Liz Gilson is up yet. I haven't heard any tweets from Nurse Liz Gilson. We'll keep her eyes. She listens in Maryland, of course, so it's probably, I don't know, about 7 o'clock in the morning there, but she's normally up and with a coffee. Now we're going to welcome our world-famous Spanish wine expert, Mr. Colin Harkness, over there in sunny Maraira, Alicante, Valencia Coast. Good morning, Colin, on wine.
Good morning. You know, these tight leather pants, I'm not sure if I'll be able to speak too well this morning.
And are you lounging in a bodega somewhere?
No, lounging in the office, in actual fact.
Lovely.
With a picture of some cava I'm just about to taste.
Oh, some cava.
A bit later on for that, because I'm doing a tasting tomorrow. But, of course, we're not about cava today, are we? We're all about, well, what are we talking about? Sherry and also the wines of D.O. Buyas, and that's no bull, as I said last week.
Fire away.
Okay, yes, well, I'm lucky because I get invited to various different judging panels here in Spain. And a couple of weeks ago, I was invited to be one of the judges for the Denominación de Origen, the D.O. Buyas. Spain, as many listeners will know, is divided up in some ways in terms of wine to various different areas of production, and most of these are called DO, Denominación de Origen. So it's a specific geographical area, and it's not actually that far away from where I'm living on the Alicante province. Going south and inland a little bit towards Murcia, it's about a 2-hour drive from where I am. And it's one of these DOs which has sort of traditionally always been living in the shadow of some of the more famous ones. Obviously, many listeners will know about Rioja, Ribera del Duero, Penedès, etc. But also, in fact, in the same sort of areas where Buyas is, there are areas known as Yecla, D.O. Jumilla, and D.O. Alicante, D.O. Valencia, of course, and even these, which are smaller than Rioja, but they're still large enough to cast a bit of a shadow over Buyas. But things are changing, and they're making a big effort now to try and get themselves out into the marketplace. And one of the ways they do that is by having a competition for all the wines there, and I suppose inviting people like myself along to make a judgment and then make a bit of a fuss about it.
I love your job.
Yes, it's not a bad job, I must admit.
You're a lucky man.
I'm not looking for any apprentices at the moment.
Just hold on a minute, Colin, because I know you can't see us, but I'm waiting for Chris Pollard to pour me some sherry while you're chatting.
Yes, so he's very slow, isn't he?
A little bit tardy.
Sorry, I know.
And also hogging it in the corner. So carry on, Colin. Sorry to interrupt.
Well, no worries. As soon as you actually have the sherry in your glass, please give me...
Yes, thank you. I have it now, the nose. Will you talk us through the nose? Do you know what we're drinking? I've forgotten.
I do, but in actual fact, I sort of wrote down my tasting notes for that particular wine some time ago, and I haven't got them with me now. But I'll tell you what, it'd be much more interesting if you tell me what you and what Chris are getting out of it.
Well, what do you think of it, Jules?
I'm finding it. It's very rich, creamy, almost thick. Yep. Colin, yep. This is my own sort of, you know, layman's terms, obviously, and I'm getting a little bit of marzipan-y sort of thing. But Chris has got the proper tasting notes.
Which style is it, Chris? Which style is it? Is it Oloroso, Amontillado?
To be frank with you, the grape is a Pedro. How do you spell it?
Jimenez.
Jimenez.
Pedro Jimenez.
Pedro Jimenez.
Yeah, so therefore that's sweet
yes,
wine, isn't it?
It is. It's beautifully sweet.
Mm.
Yes, yes. And it has aromas of raisins and molasses,
yeah.
Figs, toffee, yeah. Caramel, nuts. And it's incredibly thick on the palate. And
it is thick. It's really thick. Yes. Diane, what are you? Diane is our resident chef.
Well, yes, hello, Diane.
Hello there.
Hola.
Hola. ¿Cómo estás? Or whatever.
Yes.
Yeah, that'll do. Very good. Muy bien, gracias.
I have a little
thought for you, Diane, and others in the studio as well. Cast your mind back to Christmas when you had some Christmas pudding.
Exactly.
Now put your nose into that sherry and what do you get?
Christmas pudding.
You do
yes,
get Christmas pudding.
Yes.
Well, maybe the marzipan was in there somewhere, you see, Colin.
Yeah, absolutely, yes, of course. And as a chef, you'll know all about this, of course, but there is a very simple and absolutely delightful dessert that people can have. a lovely bit of vanilla ice cream, chuck a bit of that sherry that you've got on the top of it, and
yes.
it just is absolutely
yes.
lovely.
Actually, this is very like something I used to make years and years ago, a rum toff. With the fruit.
In the big jar.
Yeah, in the big jar. Donkeys years ago. I absolutely like that. And it's got a lovely sort of syrup all around the glass.
Could you start making it again, please?
Yes.
I do.
Was that Swiss or German?
I think it was German.
Because I think then Robbie used to wear his little lederhosen.
Absolutely.
Dance around
such
the
such cute legs.
She's big into this leather.
I'm also thinking, you know, Colin, I keep this in the fridge. Because it is beautifully chilled, and it is slightly chilled now. But I think as a summer drink, a long drink in the evening with plenty of ice in it, I think it would be beautiful.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And, of course, if you're keeping it in the fridge, you're going to get a little bit more time for it as well, because there is a misnomer, really, in as much as people think that sherry lasts forever. It doesn't. It does have a shelf life. It's longer than a regular still wine would be, but if you put it in the fridge and keep it chilled, then you're going to have really enjoy it for a couple of weeks, really.
I agree.
Well, you see, Colin changed my life saying that, because now I get through a bottle of port and bottle of sherry, you know, a couple every week.
Do you?
Because I used to keep it, you know, for a year, and Colin said you mustn't, so now we just, you know, get through it.
No, you mustn't. You've got to drink it.
Yeah.
That's true.
Quick as possible.
Yes.
Yeah.
Straw mats.
Don't try this at home, children.
Straw mats, it says here, that I'm sure they don't put it in the sherry. It says, hang on, made using grapes, dried on straw mats, fermented and fortified, and then aged under the solaria system. Colin, what is the solaria system?
Well, it's the solaria system. This is where you have a number of barrels on top of each other. There are actually three levels of barrels, and you actually disgorge the wine from the bottom barrel and then top that up with the one above it and then top it up again with the one above that. And so that means that the sherry that you're drinking could well have some in it which is up to 100 years old.
Oh,
really?
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. That's what the Solaria system is. And these are for the finer ones. And now you've got a pretty fine sherry there as well, so it may be such a wine. But that's the great thing about sherry. It does last that sort of length of time under the right conditions in the barrel, etc., before it's bottled.
Oh, sorry. Carry on, Colin. So go back to Chris. What were you saying about this now? Or are we going back onto Colin's wine? Up to you.
Well, we'll go back. I was just saying, to me, it's the ultimate sweet wine. And Colin, you also mentioned earlier on how beautiful it is when it's poured over ice cream. Mm. And I completely agree with you on that.
Yes.
Could you use this with... you know, as a dessert wine.
Yes, I suppose you could.
As a dessert wine. And, you know, when we're thinking about Christmas, I mean, I mentioned Christmas pudding, but think also Christmas cake and think mince pies.
Mm.
Could you
like
that with a mince pie? Would be lovely.
Indeed.
Love a mince pie.
I'm sorry you're not here, Colin. I'm really sorry you're not able to have a glass of this, because it is beautiful.
You know what we'll do? When I next go over to Madeira, which I'm definitely going in June. Will you be there in June, Colin? We'll try and do a live radio show with Colin over there, and we'll try and hook up.
And I can make Chris jealous then, because he'll have to tune in and we'll be having some nice wine. Yeah? Well,
I might jump on the plane.
He might be on his mountain in Turkey, of
course.
Well,
that is true.
Yeah.
That is true.
So, Colin, back to you and your bull.
Yes.
Your old bull.
Yeah. Yes, just really talking about this DO, this area of production, Buyas. They're making some really fine wines, and there's a couple of them there that are rated round about 89 to 92 marks in the major guides, and several of them were given gold medals at a very plush, a very grand evening's entertainment where we were in a restaurant and the prizes were all handed out, and there are some smashing ones. And in actual fact, I was lucky to be, coincidentally, on the table where one of the chaps who made the wine called Valche, and this is from the Bodega, which is called Bodega Monastre, which is an interesting name, because Monastre is actually the name of a grape variety. He seems to have pinched that, really, which is quite a good idea. But his wine, Valche, actually won a gold medal. And this is actually an exceptional wine, and he was on our table. And went and collected his gold medal and brought back onto the table as well. And fortunately, he brought some wine with him as well.
You have the best life. Now, if people want to come and visit a bodega, you can arrange that for them, can't you?
Absolutely. It so happens, if people wanted to go to my website, do you mind if I give
please
that
do
out now, Jules?
Please do.
The website, three W's, of course, and then it's colinharknessonwine.com. You can see all sorts there, my articles. I also write a blog now as well. And one of the things you will see on the blog is that I've just done a trip with six Americans over here from Boston, who phoned me up last week, or well, 2 weeks ago, and said, could I take them on a dual bodega tour? So last week we went out and went to a couple of bodegas. And of course, Americans, with their sort of lack of history, if you like, compared to ours over in Europe, they were fascinated to go to one particular bodega, which the current owner's family bought from the King of Spain in 1771, in fact. And the ancestor bought it at auction from the King of Spain, the King having actually confiscated it from the Jesuit monks. So it's quite an interesting story. And, of course, they loved all the architecture of it and the whole history as well.
Ah, well, that's fantastic. So thank you very much. And we will be speaking to you in April,
yeah.
No doubt, and no doubt tweeting you.
I've got a few things to do in April as well. I mean, I'll be available wherever I am, but I'm doing some judging for the International Wine and Spirits Competition.
Brilliant.
In Guildford, and I'm doing a couple of bodega trips as well. And this coming week, I'm actually taking a group of 30 people to a couple of different places towards the centre of Spain, around the Madrid area, Toro, and also Rueda, which is, of course, a famous white wine area. And also the absolutely very beautiful town of Segovia as well. So I'm a busy man at the moment, but I've always got time for you, Jules.
Well, I've always got time for you. I'd love to go to Segovia. I loved Segovia, if I can only say it. The sherry, you know. It's gone straight to my head. Colin, as ever, thank you. And we'll be speaking to you, if not before, in April.
Great pleasure. And enjoy the sherry in my absence, right?
Hasta luego.
Bye-bye, Colin. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, Chris. Bye-bye, Diane.
That's the fabulous Colin on wine as ever. He's so knowledgeable. Now we're going to play a little bit of Sally McLennan, and then we're going to come back and listen to some Taste of Kent Awards interviews that were taken. Some of them may sound a little bit slurred towards the end of the evening.
Well, Jimmy Glide, our man again, the pub where I was born. He played it from the night time to the peaceful early morn. He served the souls of psychos and the men who had the horn, and they all left very happy in the morning. But Jimmy didn't like his place in this world of ours, where the elephant man brought storm in his decks and he had too many pairs. So I sat to see the grieving of the people that I'm leaving, and he took their oath with God knows in the morning. We walked into the station in the rain. We kissed him as we put him on the train, and we sang him a song of times long gone. Oh, we knew that we'd be seeing him again. Sad to say, I must be on my way, so buy me beer and whiskey, cause I'm going far away. I'd like to think of me returning when I can, to the greatest little boozer and to Sally McLennan. The years went by and spice and shines, I grew to be a man. I learned to love the virtues of Sir Sally McLennan. I took the cheers and drank the beers and crawled back home at dawn. I ended up a barman in the morning. I pried the pump and took the hump and watered whiskey down. I took the booze and horses through the men and drank the brown. I heard the sight of Jimmy's making money far away. Some people left for heaven without warning. We walked into the station in the rain. We kissed him as we put him on the train. And we sang them a song of times long gone. Though we knew that we'd be seeing them again. I'm sad to say, I must be on my way, so buy me beer or whiskey, cause I'm going far away. I'd like to think I'll be returning when I can, to the greatest little boozer out of Sally McLennan. When Jimmy came back home, he was surprised that they were gone. He asked me all the details of the train that they went on. Some people may have scared the cock, but Jimmy drank until he choked. Took the road for heaven in the morning. We walked into the station in the rain, and we kissed him as we put him on the train. And we sang him a song of times long gone, though we knew that we'd be seeing him again. Sad to say, I must be on my way, so buy me beer and whiskey, cause I'm gone far away. I'd like to think I'll be returning when I can, to the greatest little boozer and to Sally McLennan.
at the Taste of Kent Awards. It's rocking up now. It's getting very, very tense, actually. We've had the main course. We've had the starter. I've had to order more wine, listener. It's been an absolute outrage because the wine had gone. I'm here with the fabulous Dane Alcorn. He's a fabulous Kiwi. Very excited. And he's from the Milk House. So you're up for which award, Dane?
Best Pub in Kent Award for 2015, which is an award with lots of other people involved and some great pubs in Kent. And just really pleased to be part of it.
And I think you established, I was just talking to your lovely wife, Sarah, you established in 2013.
Yes, exactly. So we've been training since September. We've been up and running for about a year and a half now. It's been a trialing year and a half, but it's, you know, had its peaks and troughs, but hopefully we're in a peak at the moment being at these awards.
Tell me about the troughs.
Well, you underestimate the want a bit of word, the exposure to red tape and councils and
councils, yes,
and conservation and all these things that have their right place in the community. But when you're starting a business, it's very difficult to understand how you get past it and alleviate the sort of problems by remedying with, want a bit of a word, compromising. So a lot of compromising.
And what are the what's your sort of passion in the restaurant?
We don't call it a restaurant purely because it's a dining room, and we're a village pub, and we source local products seasonally, and really enjoy the sort of atmosphere that we're surrounded with wonderful products in a wonderful part of the world, and it's just making sure that we can give the best we can within a reasonable price, comfortable environment, and enjoy it for the right reasons of, you know, a village pub.
And how much do you bring in from your Kiwi background?
I haven't been in New Zealand for a good 12 years now, and I've been traveling the world and working for private clients a lot before this. So I have a Middle Eastern influence, I have an Asian influence, and we try to work with the products that are surrounding us, and then have the sort of touches and exploits of those cuisines within it. So it's just square peg round hole mentality. Nothing uniform as what you'd expect in a pub.
We're wishing you lots of luck. Can you just give me a shout out for your website?
So the Milk House is www.themilkhouse.co.nz. New Zealand.
I love that. I've taken him back, listen. I've taken him back in time.
.co.uk, and it's a great website to look at, and obviously we have Facebook and Twitter, which is hashtag TN17, which you can obviously be part of and follow us in the future.
Okay, we'll wish you lots of luck. Do you know who you're up against?
No, I don't.
I think that's probably wise.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, good luck and thank you.
Thank you very much.
So that's Dane Alcorn there. Alcorn. It's not a New Zealand name, it's an English name. I'm sitting on Matthew Kearsey's knee, so I'm going to swing round and just go on and interview him. Matthew, what award are you up for, Dane?
I'm up for the Dead Knee Award, actually. No.
Are you alluding to my size?
No, Jules, I'm not up for an award this year.
Darling.
No, I ducked.
You've won so many.
Yeah, I have. I've won three in a row.
You've been on the BBC, I believe.
Oh, and all that, Jules, and all that. So now I've decided to sort of have product placement. So I've got all my jars on the table.
I noticed. And rose jelly.
And I've taken over the cheese table as well. So no, I felt that this year, because I won Kent Artisan Producer of the Year last year, I really felt that I can't hog the stage, and I'll give someone else a chance. But oh, they are just behind us there. There's Kathy from Great Preservations.
A nice one from Matthew Kearsey Lawson, and we're going to hear now from Kathy at Great Preservations. But first of all, I need to stop this interview and start it again. And I'm with Claire Hudson of Hudson's Fish in Herne Bay, a very new business. And I'm very interested to hear from Claire how it's been being nominated as such a young, brand new startup business, nominated for the Taste of Kent Awards. What is your category?
I've been nominated for Kent's Fishmonger of the Year Award.
There's a surprise.
Yeah, we are a fishmonger in Herne Bay. We opened up last August, so as you said, yeah, it's very new to us. And I just feel very privileged that our customers have nominated me, and then obviously other people have voted for us to get us here. And it's just exciting to be here, and quite a shock, really. I wouldn't imagine that we'd be here sort of within our sort of first year of opening the shop. We've been open for a couple of years before that doing our delivery service. So, yeah, and I just really thank all of the people who voted for me, because they were just... we've got a real lovely following of people in Herne Bay who are very excited about, you know, us being here, and, yeah, I feel really lucky to be here.
And running a business like this for fish, how are you getting your supplies without giving away too many trade secrets? Why do you think you've been nominated? You know, because we know that the quality of your fish is very fresh. I know, because I actually have it every week. But is that what the judges, you know, caught their eye, or was it the running of the business, do you think?
I think possibly a mixture. I mean, first and foremost, you know, the fish has got to be the best fish that we can get, fresh, as local as we can possibly get, which we do. We source our fish from Ramsgate, Broadstairs, Whitstable, Herne Bay if we can, and for other fish that is not caught in this area, we go further afield. But the most important thing for us is that it is fresh. And it's at its best. You know, we don't hold fish. It's, you know, it's always going to be at its best.
Getting crab, I know. Sometimes you said to me there's no crab. Is that because the water is too cold, or...?
It's more the weather. It's more the wind that they can't get out to go crabbing. It's often the reason why they can't get the crab and stuff. And that is the nature of our business. We're never going to... There's never going to be, you can come in every week and say, can I have this, this and this? It all depends on what's been caught. And I'd rather not have it if it's not been caught, then provide something that has been caught further afield and is not very good, you know, not very good quality. So,
just controversially, there's a very sad news that the fishmonger in Whitstable High Street has just gone, made front page news in the Whitstable Times. Do you have anything to say about that, or do you not know enough about it to comment?
I don't really know enough about it. I don't know the lady who was there. It's sad. It's a shame that it has shut. I think it had a good reputation, and it's sad all round that there are so few fishmongers in the area. We're surrounded by coast, and I just think we should all support each other, and try and eat local fish. I mean, I was speaking to someone in the trade who said probably when he started out there were 15 fishmongers in Thanet. There's now one, so it is a dying breed. But I would like to. I feel proud that we brought it back into brought it back into Herne Bay. There used to be four fishmongers in Herne Bay, there's scope to have more in Whitstable. So I think it's sad that it's gone in Whitstable, but hopefully maybe something will come up, and if not, come and see us in Herne Bay.
Not far to go. So, Claire Hudson, we're wishing you lots of luck from Scoff and Quaff Show, and we hope you win and have a lovely evening. That's Claire Hudson of Hudson's Fish.
Thank you very much, Jules.
It's been 7 hours and 50 days. You took your love away. I go out every night and sleep all day. Since you took your love away, since you've been gone, I can do whatever. Whomever I choose.
Oh, it's such a shame to fade her, but we have to press on. And I'm very sorry about the guffawing in the background of those interviews at Taste of Kent Awards. It was a very sort of bawdy affair when Matthew Kearsey Lawson arrived, and you could hear him in the background most of the time. So we have now, a while back I was invited along to a Vietnamese cookery day, which was absolutely exquisite. And my new husband is now reaping the rewards as I make him love little summer rolls and foo. And we have in the studio with us Diane Perry, who studied food and nutrition at uni. And I believe she was a head teacher in Belgium, but she does a lovely, lovely lesson. Not at all strict, lots of fun. And we sat down, had wine and tasted. And lovely Robbie was in the background, you know, looking after us all. And a big welcome to you. And you've brought lots of lovely goodies and the macaroons or macarons. What do we say?
These are macaroons. They're English and go very, very well with the... the sherry.
They do.
They do, don't
yes.
they?
Diane Perry is in the studio. So she's going to tell us all about what made you decide to open your cookery studio in Faversham, Battlesmere?
Well, gosh, it's
you
one
tell
of those...
me and I'll eat.
Okay.
And what am I eating? This chocolate, lovely.
Oh, that's for your gluten-free. Mm. Lots of peanut butter and all the calories in the world. And I know yesterday you said to me you were on a diet, so I thought, right, well, we'll give her the right sort of diet.
Her one weakness.
Yes.
Protein. Carry on.
No, but we, having returned from Brussels, where I'd been, I have had a sort of very varied career path over the years, and having returned to England, I decided that I wanted to go back to my original love, which was food and nutrition. I've cooked throughout my life, and through my teaching life, I've also made sure that even though I've been the head teacher, that I was one of the fun guys, because I gave lots and lots of cookery lessons.
You are.
To parents and to children as well, and I've got a real passion for food, healthy eating.
You made us all feel so welcome. It was a nice small group, listener. But Diane and Robbie just made us feel like part of the family. It was lovely.
Well, the lovely thing about it is that now that we've come back home, the kids have left home. Mm. And what are we going to do if we love food? Mm. Dinner parties, lunch parties, eat out. So what better than to use all the skills and to do the teaching, which I love the teaching, I love the food, and I love people. So
using all your skills?
Yeah.
Sorry if I've got my mouth full, listener. Carry on, Diane.
I can't eat.
No, this is my chance.
Okay. So basically, we've planned a whole series of courses, taking my strengths mainly, but my key strength is baking, patisserie, Italian, all sorts of entertaining types of repertoire. And so we've devised quite a lot of courses, in fact. And I'm a sole trader, so I'm told. But Robbie's in the background as the inspiration, I think. He keeps me on my toes. And I do have a sort of a very good friend who's a travel writer, a traveller and a writer, I should say, who is a great chef as well. So she pops in.
What's her name?
Her name's Debbie Cook. She pops in to do...
Debbie Cook?
Debbie Cook, mm-hmm. Yeah. And she is one of my dearest friends and a sort of great cook. So she's very good on Asian, and she did a very good course on Take One Chinese Chicken, and everybody played with the chicken for a whole day. I particularly... I'm interested at the moment in doing a course which is for couples that cook.
Yes.
We had very late on, about a week before Valentine's, I thought, well, wouldn't this be rather nice to have a cooking evening? Mm. So arranged the course, put it on the website, and nobody booked. Of course, it was, you know, it's not good business to plan something a week before the event. So decided Robbie ought to take me out instead, which he didn't. And one lovely young woman phoned up and said, but I've seen your course. Why aren't you running it? So I said, well, look, you'll be the only person, but do come along. And so the two of them came along. And apparently Valentine's is their great thing. Mm. And last year was in Paris. So this year she had done a wine tasting course in the morning, and she was here in Kent doing the cookery. So, you know, it shows that Kent's got a lot to offer. And so they arrived, having just been in quite a major car accident. And they arrived in the Cookery studio, started to make their meal. We set it out beautifully for them. They prepared cocktails for all of us, all four of us, as part of the course. And we had such an uproarious evening. I heard him saying to her, "This is better than being in Paris last year."
Oh, really?
That was great for us. And there was only a couple, but, you know, we were starting from small things. Mm. But some of the other courses have been full.
Well, I have to say, listener, the facilities that you've done, you've thought about it really well, and all the induction hobs and everything was there. It was very, very easy. As you said, it was very non-stressful, beautiful environment. I was very impressed.
It is. Everybody's mentioned that. Yeah. It's really nice for us because we put a lot of effort into it.
I can tell. So, yeah. Absolutely. There was, you know, I said to my husband, you know, you just, the whole thing was very, very relaxed, which is half the thing. Of course, my chopping skills were not quite up to standards.
By the time you left, I think they were.
They were improving, weren't they? They were improving. So what have you got coming up? You've got this cooking for couples, which I think sounds great.
It's come out of the Valentine's, yes. And I'm going to do that once every 5 weeks, something like that.
And so do they arrive at 4 p.m?
Yeah.
Okay, so they arrive at 4, and then what do? They just start...
They start to... obviously, everybody who's there will get to know each other, and then we go straight into the kitchen, and we start preparing. And I have it planned so that they can eat their meal in stages, and hopefully not have to come back to the kitchen too much, but inevitably, if you're making a meal, you have to keep going watching what's on the stove. So they can then have quite a nice romantic meal because the setting is so lovely.
Yes, it is.
And they can enjoy what they've made together. And the repartee between each other is really nice. And when we've done other courses, because you're doing it for couples, but also the couples are bonding as well. So I think that's the sort of the dream. It's a new thing. It's a new idea. You want to go out in the evening, but you want to do something different and creative.
Yeah.
You're learning at the same time.
And you see all those couples, you know, on Valentine's Day straining to make conversation sometimes in those,
you know. You've got the other couples
bistros
to help you.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I was just going to say, I think that's a wonderful idea. I really, really do. And I was just looking at my wife, Miriam, in the green room, and I'm thinking that's probably something we should do. You know, it's a great invention. Very good.
Yeah.
Excellent. Excellent. Good luck to you.
There's another lovely course that they're running, and it's impressive, entertaining, stress-free. I love the idea of that.
Mm-hmm.
And also just going through artisan bread making and enriched doughs.
Oh, those are really my passions.
I bet they're very popular, the
bread
making.
They are, actually. Yeah. And that's great to know.
And then you've got this holiday cooking for young chefs, and that's on Wednesday the 8th of April, and that's £65. It's from 10 a.m. till 2. So tell us about that, because they're going to make, how do I say that?
Quesadilla.
Yeah. I'd say quesadillas.
No, I do have Mexican family. I don't speak Spanish, unlike your other guest, but I'm trying. I need to know what they're saying, actually.
But you love Mexican food, don't you?
Love Mexican. I love ethnic food, street food, just... I think we all do, because you get the real intensity of flavours without the food being messed around.
Mm.
But for the impressive entertaining, I mean, for me, it's the... There are so many skills to share with people who are absolutely scared.
Yeah.
And that's where my teaching and the fact that I've been doing this for donkey's years, that I have so many skills to share. That sounds pompous. It's not meant to be.
No.
It's trying to give people the tips and ideas. And it's a passion, I suppose. But for the children, I mean, having worked in prep schools, you know, a lot of them, sadly, their parents are working, don't have time to spend on food, and they try their best, but the children don't have the skills that they probably learnt from granny. So I make a very good granny.
That were passed down.
Yeah.
That were passed down. Chris, you've got to ask me, get ready to ask me the question of who's on the show next week. But yeah. I've lost my piece of paper, so you'll have to tell me.
Well, I'll be frank with you, I've lost my piece of paper. Well.
Well, while you rummage, see, Diane, you can tell she was ahead.
I was just going to ask Diane, where did you...
Diane's got it. Go on.
I was just going to ask you, where did you learn your artisan bread making?
Mm. Where did I learn it?
Yes.
Well, a lot of it I've just developed over the years, but I did do quite a lot of courses with Bertinet in Bath.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Bertinet's huge, isn't
huge,
it?
Yeah. Really good.
Yeah.
And one place that was down in Devon, the bread making there was interesting. I took issue with their that they're sort of enriched dough, which was really hard to make because they had so much butter in it. But apart from that, really, really great outdoors, making pizza out in pizza ovens and so forth. So, yeah, I suppose they all of those places give you inspiration. But it's like, you know, How to Bake and all those books, you know, that the guy on the baking show.
Oh, Paul Hollywood.
Yes. You know, all of those books that he produces, and Bertinet and so forth, they've got wonderful skill sets to share with everybody. So it's what I want to do is give everybody the feel of what you make something once, you know what it looks like, you feel it, and then hopefully you can go away and do it, and then you can use their recipes.
Yes.
I love the idea of the, as you say, the skills not being passed down now, and you're actually sort of stepping in there, because we parents do work, and it is tough. The other day I impressed myself. I thought of you. I was going to ring you because I had a really busy week. It was Taste of Kent Awards and things were happening, and I was trying to lose a bit of weight for my new husband's book launch at Frontier Funds next Wednesday 25th at Bloomberg offices. And I did an hour of cooking, and I just made up the basics for 3 days. I was very impressed. So I did two soups, a leek and potato and my famous chicken soup. Which has now developed into a pho, of course. And then I did a ratatouille because I was just like chopping. You can imagine all the seasonal stuff that I had from Riverford. And then all I really had to do was just add different bases to the ratatouille, rice and pasta. And we had a decent soup for 3 days. So I think maybe that's the way forward when people are busy. Do you planning?
I don't plan my weekly shopping. It just happens through inspiration. We were talking about this before. And I find that one of the best things I tend to do, occasionally it goes wrong, but is to get the wok out at the end of, you know, just before you go shopping, put everything together. And there's usually a bit of lovely stock in the fridge, you know, still some fresh ingredients, chili and blue cheese. Blue cheese. It makes anything work.
Well, you know, our next guest, Miriam, who'll come on later on the Business Bunker, she's brought me some fresh chili from Turkey. And the flavour, she gave it to me a couple of years ago, was just divine. I just kept sprinkling it on anything. Is there any smoked salmon in the studio?
Well, there is, funny enough. Look, I've got a box of it here.
Yes. Well, go on. Diane, just can you give us a lovely shout for your website?
Ah, the three W's.
Yes.
Cookery Studio Kent. .co.uk.
Brilliant. They are in Faversham, Battlesmere, so you will find them there. I highly recommend it, and I'm sure Chris and I will be doing something along those lines.
I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah.
Do you make pastry?
I don't make pastry, but I have been saying to Miriam recently, I have got to start. I enjoy cooking, the little that I do, and it is, I think, about being patient.
It
and
is.
Being prepared to learn.
And give yourself some time.
Yes, yeah. Yes, and time. Yes, that's very true. That's very true.
I'd like to say a big welcome to Venom Tech, who are listening in. And they said maybe Steve's cake-making skills could see him on the Scoff and Quaff show sometime. I'm not really sure about that. I've just looked at their picture. They're 5 years old today, so well done. And I was thinking it was Discovery Pork, but it's actually Discovery Park. So I was going along with the food theme there. So, Chris, have you got anything else to read? And who is on the show next week, pray tell?
Well, you've got the list for who's on the show next week.
Well, I'll tell you then, shall I?
I'll tell you one thing.
Are
we
haven't
done.
Are you going to be on with me?
No, unfortunately,
no,
I'm not.
I'll be on my own.
Well, we haven't mentioned our sponsors.
No, who are our sponsors?
Our sponsors this week were Ales for Farmers Market and Gluten-Free Bakey.
Bakey One.
Bakey One, yes. So thank you very much for sponsoring us.
Thank you very much. That Bakey, the one, always gets missed off, and it shouldn't. And also, I know who my co-presenter is. It's the naughty Mr. Harry Covert. Nobody knows who he is. He is, of course, Fine Dining, Secret Dining, there in Kent. He will be my co-presenter. Not as organised as you, Chrissy. Not as organised as you.
I've been well trained.
You know, exactly. Now, we also have next week on Show 84, we have Steve Wood, the lovely roving reporter, and he's going to be at the International Exhibition for Food. And you can follow him on at Love Chilies. And, of course, he was the debonair man in the picture that we were tweeting out who won the Aylesford Farm.
Yeah, it was a lovely photograph.
With the team.
Yes, it really was. Lovely photograph.
And he looked lovely. I mean, you've never seen him like that, have you?
No, I haven't, actually. He's normally got a woolly hat on.
Any news? Have you got a little snippet there?
There is a little snippet here, actually. And the snippet is above something which says Sex Pistols single sold for £6,000. But I don't think that's relevant, actually. It's a Cornish pasty prize won by a Chilean. A Chilean miner, not as in miner, young, but a miner underneath the ground, stole the show at the World Party Pasty Championships by beating his Cornish competition.
Excellent.
Now, I don't know how to pronounce that, but anyway, the Chilean gentleman won the Open Savoury Amateur Prize with his Empanada Chilena, a traditional Chilean pasty made with beef, onion, hard-boiled egg, olives and sultanas. That sounds very nice.
It does.
The gentleman in question, whose name I can't pronounce, cannot speak English, and I can't speak Chilean, decided to take part in the contest while on a two-month visit to the UK to see his wife Gail Cleverdon's family. There were also pasty makers from the US and Canada at the championships held on Saturday at the Eden Project in Bedelver, Cornwall, to celebrate the British delicacy.
I love that. I'd like to say a big goodbye to all of our guests today, the fabulous Colin Hartness in Maraira in Alicante, Valencia. Of course, Diane Perry from the Cookery Studio, and a big hello to Robbie. And a big hello to them both there, Beavering Way. And do go and try out one of their cookery extravaganzas. Who else do I thank? Oh, Taste of Kent Awards, of course, for all the interviews, and the lovely Chris Pollard, very debonair. Tune in next week. Follow us on Scoff Quaff. For now, goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Channelradio.co.uk.
Another great Jules Serkin, Scoff and Quaff show on Channel Radio. No alpacas were consumed during this production.
And I roll my breakfast because I'm a hungry man. I say shake, rattle and roll.
On Channel Radio.
Channelradio.co.uk.
It's been 7 hours and 15 days since you took your